Hello, welcome to Organic Elegance. I'm your host, Felicia Heinsohn. Today's attire is sponsored by Close Mentor of Allentown, PA. I am here with Leo Cicone from Geoenergy LLC and Renewable Energy Design Build Contract located in Temple, PA. He'll be answering some questions about solar power PV and how they can help sustain your well-being at home or in business. Leo? So one of the questions I have for you today is, can you explain how solar power works for everybody?
Solar power utilizes a polycrystalline solar cell that basically the sunlight's photons, or the light of the sun comes and strikes the silicone, and that in turn releases an electron from the bottom of the silicon cell, which then is carried away to your inverter to turn to that makes DC power, and then that's converted to AC power. And that's the simple version of it. No moving parts.
Well, thank you. Where in Temple are you located, and where will you install in the future?
We're located at 5004 Mount Vernon Street in Temple, PA. We install in Montgomery County, Berks County, Chester County, Schuylkill County, and Lehigh County. We try to stay local so that we can service our clients better.
Well, thank you. How did you get involved in sustainable energy, and when did your business open?
I had an interest in solar energy ever since I was a young boy. My father was in the aerospace program, and when he had told me how these spacecraft and satellites were powered utilizing these solar cells some 50 years ago, I was just amazed, and I said, can we get them and run our house with them? He just laughed at me because they were so expensive back then. They were like over $300 per watt. And now they're less than $2 a watt. So
wow, that's a big improvement.
It's a huge difference, yes. Makes it work or not work financially. They've always worked physically, but you know, the financial aspect has to make sense.
Yeah, for the common person to have one, it does. Well, thank you for explaining a little bit about solar power. Next, I'd like to discuss some common misconceptions about solar power that people have or thought about over the years, and if you can clear it up for us, that'd be great. So one of the ones is, electric companies, I was told or was heard over time, they can buy electric back from people who have power installed in their home. Can you explain how that works?
Sure. The PUC in Pennsylvania, the Public Utility Commission, basically passed a law or a tariff that said that they being the utility companies, have to buy the power back. And the method of buying it back is with a net meter. A net meter is another way of saying is it a bi-directional meter. So it records how much power you put into the grid and how much power you take out of the grid.
Yeah.
And then your utility company bills you based on the net difference. And our objective is always, for our company's mission objective, is to always get you to a zero energy point so that you don't have any electric bill. You get a physical bill, but it hopefully will be in parentheses. So that basically means whatever that number is, you're getting, they owe you rather than you owe them.
Is the pay return or the profit worthwhile? Like, is it kind of long, or does it take a long time, or is it kind of short? Like, or does it vary?
As time goes by, it's getting shorter and shorter. The return on your investment, I guess, is what we're saying. And basically, right now for a homeowner, it's approximately 5 years or less, depending on how much power that they use.
Wow.
And for a business, it can be as short as a year with accelerated tax benefits, et cetera, so they can literally have their investment back in approximately a year and a half.
And it varies, I guess, as well, depending on the location and how much sunlight you actually are hitting.
Well, yeah,
and stuff like that.
You have to have a good location. That's all what I'm saying about production and returns on investment is based on having a good site. Yeah. Where you're facing true south path in the path of the sun.
So when someone is thinking about getting solar power for their home, but they may be having to leave or resell their home in a recent time and they think it's not worth it, is it worth it to actually have installed, and then does the value of the house go up?
The Real Estate Institute has stated that it increases the resale value by approximately, I think, forget the organization that manages it. It might be Fannie Mae, but don't quote me on that. I believe that it's valued presently at $3 per watt. So if the system is, say, a 10,000 watt system, that would be have an equated value of approximately $30,000 added to the value of the house.
Yeah.
And in reality, we're selling the systems for less than $3 a watt. So,
oh, wow.
So you, in a sense, have an instant equity situation. So that point is one. And then the other point is that the homes that have solar energy in place on them sell faster. I don't remember what the percentage is. I don't want to misquote it, but it increases your decreases the length of time it takes to sell your home.
Can you install one panel or must be many at a time? And is it better? What's the better, to install a few or more at a time?
Well, your value of economics is to install enough to cover your entire demand, like okay. based on our subjective opinion that you replace all your power. That would be your least cost per watt. But it is possible, and we utilize microinverters instead of a central, large, single string inverter. And with the microinverters, you can increase or add to the system because it's all AC and it has a plug-and-play scenario. So,
can you kind of explain to everybody what a microinverter is and how it actually kind of works a little bit?
Sure. A microinverter is an inverter, but it's micro, meaning it's about the size, I always say, of a small ham sandwich that goes underneath each solar panel. Like I could show you here in this picture if you wanted, but there's racking that goes up, and then on the racking, we bolt inverters, and then the solar panel then sits over top of each inverter, and then it's connected the DC wires. Like in this case, these are 40 volt solar panels, 315 watt, and that gets just plugged, two plugs, positive and negative, gets plugged into the small inverter. Then the small inverter has a cable that connects to, that's your AC side of the inverter, because what the inverter is doing, to answer your question, the original question was, it's turning DC direct current into alternating current,
okay.
which is what our homes and businesses use. And it can be single phase, three phase, any voltage or phasing configuration we can produce with solar.
Can you have any other pictures on there you'd like to share with us that might involve what you're talking about?
This is a home here in Muhlenberg, Pennsylvania, with the microinverters and 68 solar panels. And the owner of this home actually has an electric car and is planning on getting two more electric cars.
Oh, wow.
So their whole family would be completely zero energy with their transportation, and also with the home is zero energy to start with. I think they have about a $700 credit right now on their electric bill.
Wow. So when you explain that a little bit, when it comes to when someone has a solar panel on their home and the solar grid, is it the electric companies in general, they're connected, how do they work together when it comes to they're becoming a generator?
Exactly. The process is we take care of all the paperwork, but you apply to the local utility company that services you, and they approve, hopefully, which they have never not approved, but this power generation agreement so that you can push power back to the grid when you're not using it. So they become, in essence, your battery, they being the utility company.
Oh, wow.
So the grid ties are the most cost-effective way to go.
Mm-hmm. So can you kind of explain a little bit what happens when there's bad weather and how it will affect the solar production?
Cloudy days, you're going to get less power. But as long as there's daylight, I know that sounds sort of like a silly statement, but as long as there's some daylight, it'll make power. Now, it won't make the rated power. So your best power is going to be made, of course, in the summer months where the sun is more direct overhead. But even in the summer, if you have a lot of clouds, it's going to make less power. It's subjective to like how much less. It depends on how many clouds, whatever. But I was always amazed that it could be literally raining and cloudy and stormy, and it's still making some power.
Can you explain to us a little bit how, in general, it works, how solar power helps the environment? Like you have a picture on your slideshow that explains how. Yeah, I guess it's with your own home.
Yes, this is a depiction that's on a cloud-based program that's connected, that everyone that purchases the system has access to their own system to see all the specs for instance, this site has replaced or displaced 108 tons of carbon since it was installed about 9 years ago.
That's a big improvement for just one home.
Yeah, it's like four dump truck loads of carbon that we don't have to breathe. That's something I feel proud that I'm contributing or not contributing.
Well, it's something when you think about it, you don't realize over a long period of time how a little bit can really add up.
Exactly.
And I really like how this explains and kind of shows, it's a nice simple visual of how one home can really help many other areas in the environment.
Exactly. Water, air quality, air quality, contamination in the ground. It all comes back around. It's like the settlers used to not get their drinking water downstream from where they were disposing of their waste, if that makes any sense. So we just got to take better stewardship of where we're putting our dirt.
We're all working at it. So thank you for sharing with us about the misconceptions and how new ideas and awareness for solar power. Next, I would like to talk about how you support the local community and the nonprofits you like to support. Which is the one you support the most?
It's probably even between the Gray Muzzle Manor and
Animal Rescue League?
Yes, Animal Rescue League. And basically the reason I support them is because I love animals. And I don't like to see them suffer. And they do a great job at taking care of them. For instance, Gray Muzzle Manor is kind of like an old folks home for animals. They have horses, pigs, cows, dogs. You name it, they have the animals there, and the people that run it are so loving and caring. It's just it's a breath of fresh air to see someone take ownership of something like a stray dog and never let it go until it's time.
Did you ever have any? Did you ever adopt or?
Yes, yeah. All my pets have been adopted.
I have a cat for sure that he was adopted. Well, he was found as a stray, and there was another one we had that was a stray as well, and they do really well and they're spoiled. That happens when you're a pet owner.
We have a cat right now, and he's like a dog. I mean, he follows me around. I think I didn't teach him to heel, but he heels whenever I walk. Oh. He's like right at my heels.
So you kind of shared a little bit of why you support the community with it, and can you explain how long you've been supporting them?
Over 20 years, I would say. Wow. Well, not Gray Muzzle Manor. That was something in the last 5 years, but the Animal Rescue League.
Well, thank you. I would also like to go back to some of your pictures and can share with us some information about each one.
Sure. We can just start at the top here. This is a rooftop system. I had showed the first pictures I was showing were on a ground mount. The ground mount means it's literally mounted onto a racking system that's attached to the ground physically. There's no building in between it.
Oh, wow.
Where this picture depicts a system that has racking that's mounted and flashed to an existing roof on a house over in Muhlenberg. And
like the one behind us, actually.
Yes,
similar.
Exactly. And from a perspective of a homeowner, it's probably complicated, but from, the fact that we do it all the time, it's fairly simple, straightforward. We go in and lay it out and put the flashings on the roof with the little mounts, and then we put our rails on and our inverters and then place the solar panels on top and then interconnect that with a wire cable system down to the meter, basically. It's like the short version. But there's no other equipment needed because everything you need is literally on the roof or on the ground right underneath the solar panel with the inverter.
Earlier we were talking about how you're kind of connected with the grid. So what happens when the power goes off?
Well, the grid tie system is the most economical system, like I mentioned. But with that, when the grid goes down, your solar panels stop producing. It's required by law, and when you tie into the grid, that you don't push power back when the grid is off, regardless of why it's off, for safety purposes.
Oh, okay.
Because if, say, for instance, it was producing and the lines were cut and the utility worker thought that the power was off, and it is off from the perspective of where the generator is normally located, but if you had this producing, if the sun was up, it could be pushing 240 volts back through the transformer, and that gets turned back into 7,000 volts, and someone could get hurt.
Okay.
So they make
sense.
It simple. But there is a hybrid system that we provide that has a transfer switch that physically disconnects the grid and has sensing devices so that it's safer and it's physically disconnected just the way the
I guess that's a good way to let people know that I guess the difference, because sometimes I just, they might not think of it, because sometimes I don't even realize it.
We always inform our customer when we're going through the contracting process that, you know, make it clear to them this: if the power goes off, your power will go off. This is not a completely autonomous system.
Well, thank you. Let's go back to our next picture.
This is a ground mount. Again, this is 80 solar panels. It's over 25,000 watts total, 315 watts each. And it pushes over 80 amps of power, 240 volts.
What does that power, what does that kind of relate to?
Can someone run a whole house.
Okay, wow, that's a lot of
power. Yeah, that's a lot of power. We have some systems that have over 800 panels. And I mean,
thank
there's
you,
systems
sunlight.
That are thousands of panels. You know, I like to build them, but we haven't done that yet.
Yeah. Next picture.
That's that same house over in Muhlenberg.
Oh, okay.
With the 68 solar panels. This is
and that's the backside of a panel and how they work? Okay.
This is the backside of an array. Now, this is the array I showed you with the 80 solar panels, mm-hmm. the picture that we were talking about prior. But this is utilizing central and string inverters. There's five inverters on the back of this system, and all these DC wires interconnect to those inverters. It does the same exact thing as this microinverter, but it does it on a larger scale.
Next one. Okay.
Wrong way. Boy, that house shows up a lot.
Wow, it's really pretty.
That's the same roof that we were showing from the top.
Okay.
This is looking from
Can
the ground.
Can you kind of see some of the parts of how the panels are mounted a little bit closer in the bottom?
Yeah, across the bottom between the gutter and you see shingle, like a lighter line for the shingles, and then in that dark black area you can see the end of the rails that literally hold the solar panels across the roof. And there's an air gap there. The funny thing is once you put solar panels on that roof, all the area that the panels are located, it protects the shingles from the sun and hail. We just had hail damage at our house, and all of the shingles were ruined around it, but where the solar panels were, they weren't touched. It
okay.
just bounced off them. They're designed to take up to a 1-inch ball of hail. They're made out of tempered glass.
Oh, I was wondering about that. So what happens with the weather, because with the hail, so they are protected with the glass?
Yeah, they're protected. They're designed to be safe up to a 1-inch ball of hail, which is pretty
okay.
big ball of hail. It's larger than a quarter.
Yeah, some around here were really big, like golf ball size in recent years. That was crazy.
Yes. Let's see, another picture. That's that same house, but pulled
different.
Back.
Okay.
From the driveway as you're pulling up. That was just done a couple months ago. This is another ground mount that's over in Temple. There's actually two arrays that look just like that, one in front of the other. They're staged far enough apart that one doesn't shadow the other. I think that might be all of the pictures we have.
Okay. Well, thank you for sharing with the pictures.
You're welcome.
What else? During your installation process, have you ever had any really interesting installation experiences they like to share?
I could think of one. We had a system up in Hamburg, and solar panels were mounted on an array that he wanted to expand, and we expanded. It's a single post array, and that was an interesting job. And he also had a wind turbine there. But what I found was interesting that in that regard was his one wind turbine, which was a 4,000 watt wind turbine, a 4 kW wind turbine, didn't produce as much as two of these solar panels in a year.
Wow.
In a year. So he was like, wow, I made a mistake buying the wind turbine. He's got a lot of wind. I mean, most of the time we were working up there, that thing was whistling. It was moving. But it's just not as efficient as the sun shines more consistently, and they produce more for less, meaning you don't have any moving parts. So like a wind turbine, you have to change the bearings approximately mm-hmm. every 3 to 5 years, and then the motor head has to be changed every 10 years, where these are guaranteed by the manufacturer for 25 years, including the inverters.
Well, I know up in the Gamums here and like out towards the Charlottesville area, on top of the mountain, you can look at overlooks and you'll see some wind turbines way in the distance. I'm not sure what part of the
Schuylkill County, the commercial turbines.
Yes, I don't know what they are. I see them out there. I'm like, oh, they're cute.
That's viable. The large turbines produce enough power to offset your maintenance costs. The problem with the smaller ones is they don't give you the production you need to offset the initial cost. He said he paid like $40,000 for that system.
Already you informed me that you are involved with geothermal. Can you kind of mention briefly a little bit about that?
Sure. Geothermal heating and cooling, it's referred to as stage two geothermal. Stage one geothermal utilizes the literal hot steam coming up from the depths of the earth, mm-hmm. and that steam then in turn turns like a turbine. The turbine then turns a generator. And that's how you would get type one. But what we are involved with is type two, which is utilizing the fact that, say in Pennsylvania, anywhere below 6 feet, it's 55 degrees all year long. So what we do is we place a heat sink or a coil system down there and circulate water through that coil system with a small 40-watt pump.
Like a radiator kind of thing? Like
it's just a plastic pipe.
Oh, okay.
But it has the same effect as a heat sink or a radiator. So it'll, like in the summertime, what you do is the system is doing is taking the heat out of your air, which is air conditioning, mm-hmm. and the waste heat, instead of throwing it outside, like with a unit that sits outside, it pushes it back down into the earth through that water pipe. And then as the pipe circulates, it's about 150 foot of depth for every ton of heating. So a 3 foot system, a 3 ton system would have about 450 foot of drill.
Wow.
And then it just turns around, the water comes back up the pipe right next to the pipe that goes down. So it only takes like 40 watts to push that water down through there. So because you're not burning anything to get your heat, it's over 500% efficient, because what you're doing is you're moving heat or heat pumping. You're moving that heat from one place to the other. And then in the wintertime, you reverse that process and you bring the heat up from the earth into your house. And the refrigeration system concentrates it, meaning instead of it being 55 degree air blowing around, that would feel cold, it'll make that air all the way up to 140 degrees.
Wow.
You know, like a regular heating system.
Yeah. Well, I'm trying to think of anything specific that we would like to tell everybody and let everyone know about solar power and a little bit about geothermal. In the future, where do you think things are going to be headed for solar power?
I think the future for solar power is immense in the sense that there is no... there's no downside to it. I mean, there's places that are now recycling the old panels that, you know, say someone decided they didn't want them on their building for whatever reason, or they have to tear their building down to make a bigger building or something like that. There's places that you can take your panels to be recycled. In the future, because I believe, and I've seen it, and like in the case where people are starting to drive electric vehicles, or actually electric vehicles are outselling gas-powered vehicles right now, as far as the more elite, you know, $40,000 or $50,000 range cars are actually being sold more. The electric cars are being sold more than the gas-powered. Gas-powered cars.
It's 15, for the future.
Exactly. I mean, the reality is it's happening. It's not a
like
before. It was a guess or a theory, but it's moving forward. Like electric cars, I believe, over 85% or 90% efficient. A gasoline-powered car is 15% efficient.
I know, it's so sad.
So for every dollar you put out, you're getting 15 cents worth of motion.
Yeah.
And with every dollar you put out with an electric car, you're getting 85 cents worth of motion or 90 cents worth of motion. So it costs like $3 or $4 to charge a car. You can drive 320 miles. That's pretty good value.
Yeah, I would say. Well, thank you very much on that information.
You're welcome.
Where else do you think... in the geothermal direction, things are going ahead?
I believe that we should actually maybe mandate this to the home, the newer homes that are built, the new homes that are built, to have solar, like California did, mm-hmm. where they require you have a specific or a minimum amount of solar panels on your home to produce power, and also the fact that instead of utilizing fossil fuels to heat your house, that you use a 500% efficient method, which would help the environment and help financially. Once you have it in place, it just keeps running. You know, a geothermal system will run for 30 years, where a standard heating and cooling system will run for 5 to 10 years and you have to replace it.
Yeah.
So you get a much better value.
Well, thank you for sharing with all that information. Where can people find you exactly again? I don't know if you mentioned the area you're at, but can you let them know how to find you? They want to ask you questions or anything?
We're on the web at www.reddingpasolarcontractors.com, where you can just Google the company name, Geoenergy LLC, and we'll come up.
Is there anything in the pictures in the drive?
Of our building, no, I don't believe that's in there.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, thank you very much for sharing that information.
You're welcome.
And I'm looking forward to more people looking into getting solar power, just getting more educated. Sometimes the more education you have for getting a new form of energy is worth the investment anyways. So, thank you very much. My name is Felicia Heinsohn. I also was here with the sponsoring for Close Mentor of Allentown, Pennsylvania. Thank you for the jacket, I love it. Until then, I want to thank you and have a good day here at BCTV. Thank you for all their work. Thank you, bye.